Good evening, and thanks for joining us on your Friday. I'm Sophie Erber. Earlier today, the verdict was read for Paul Belk, who was charged in the stabbing of his mother and sister, killing his mother. It's our top story at 5. Evidence does show that Paul Belk willfully and deliberately stabbed his adoptive mother, Lisa Belk, 16 times with two knives and a pair of scissors. Judge Jeffrey Neary found Belk guilty of second-degree murder for Lisa Belk's death and not guilty of willful injury in Susan Belk's stabbing. He was also found guilty of possession of marijuana. Neary denied Belk's insanity defense, saying he was exaggerating and that at the time of the incident, Belk could distinguish right from wrong.
The court's verdict is on count one, he is guilty of murder in the second degree. On count two, not guilty of willful injury and all the lesser included offenses. And on count three, he's found guilty. Is raised as a defense, the court.
He now faces a 50-year sentence for second degree murder and 6 months on the possession charge. Sentencing has now been set for November 12th. And authorities say a 17-year-old surrendered himself to detectives today. This in connection to last week's shooting on Nebraska Street. Aaron D. Word of Sioux City is now charged as an adult for attempted murder, willful injury, and other weapons charges. He was taken to the Woodbury County Juvenile Detention Center. Sioux City PD say that the shooting victim is still in the hospital tonight recovering from injuries. And investigators say it could take weeks to identify the human remains found in a bean field on Thursday. The body is that of an adolescent boy, and investigators say clothing items found near the remains are similar to those of missing 11-year-old Xavier Harrelson of Montezuma. It was a farmer who tipped off police after finding those remains. Authorities add it could take weeks, if not months, before positively identifying those remains.
We've said it so many times, they may think it's something irrelevant, but anything that they have, let us know and let law enforcement be the judge of that, because sometimes it just takes the smallest piece of information.
Xavier's family is being kept updated by authorities on all of these developments. They did say in a Facebook post today that they have no comment on the investigation at this time. The Ottawa Police Department is officially dissolved as of today. The Monona County Sheriff's Office will now take over law enforcement duties there until the year 2026. Ottawa has a population of 2,800 people, and city leaders say they were unable to hire enough police officers. The County Sheriff's Office has since hired 5 new deputies, 4 due to law enforcement demand in Ottawa. Nebraska restaurants, like everywhere else in the nation, are struggling to find employees, and some local eateries are feeling the effects. Robles Taqueria has had to start raising their wages to try and keep their employees. La Real Minocana, an ice cream shop, has to close an extra 2 days a week now. Zoe Olson with the Nebraska Restaurant Association says, if you look at the numbers, right now, there are just not enough residents to fill the amount of work needing to be done. She says things are projected to get better by next summer, but again, nothing is certain. In national news, after funding the government and narrowly averting a shutdown, Democrats in Congress are shifting their focus to President Joe Biden's domestic agenda. ABC's Aika Jachi is in Washington with the very latest.
Today, President Biden joining the high-stakes negotiations on Capitol Hill.
He wants to speak directly to members, answer their questions, and make the case for why we should all work together to give the American people more breathing room.
At stake, passage of the $1 trillion bipartisan infrastructure bill, meant to address improvement to the nation's roads, bridges, and broadband internet, and the larger spending package that will provide funding for initiatives like climate change, paid family leave, universal pre-K and childcare, and lowering the cost of prescription drugs. After failing to bring the infrastructure bill to the floor Thursday, Speaker Nancy Pelosi signaling the divide between moderate and progressive Democrats is narrowing. House Progressive Caucus Chair Representative Pramila Jayapal confident a deal will be reached, but it will take time.
We're doing everything we can to get quickly to an agreement. And listen, we are going to pass these two things.
We've seen more progress in the last 48 hours than we have seen in a long time.
Still, moderate Senator Joe Manchin holding firm, telling reporters that $1.5 trillion is his top number on the social spending bill.
I cannot accept our economy or basically our society moving towards an entitlement mentality.
But the White House and progressive Democrats say the cost of their budget bill will be fully paid for.
Ike Ajachi, ABC News, Washington.
And it's time now to turn our attention to another local headline tonight. Chief Meteorologist Scott Larson standing by. Scott, after talking about how dry it's been for so long, you have some actual measurable rainfall totals for us.
Exactly, yeah. It's been about, 10 days since we started to have that rain happen yesterday, and it persisted through this morning. In some places, we got quite a bit of precipitation, over 3.5 inches on the ground in Estherville, about 2.5 inches in Lamar's, 2.4 inches in Sioux City, just over an inch in Concord, Nebraska, and 2/3 of an inch in Vermilion, South Dakota. So not quite as heavy of a dose of precipitation west of I-29, but areas in northwest Iowa certainly got slammed with a lot of rain. If you're headed out to tonight's football games, expect to see cloudy skies, a few showers. Sports Zone game of the week is between Newell Fonda and Remsen St. Mary's. Of course, we'll have all the action from that game and more coming up in Sports Zone later on tonight, and your full forecast in a few minutes. Sophie.
All right, looking forward to that. Thanks a lot, Scott. Well, the latest mural in the West 7th Corridor Improvement Project is now incorporating several cultures. The artist known as Royal Dog is creating a mural which represents the African-American, Southeast Asian, and Jewish communities who have lived in the West 7th Street Corridor over the many years. He estimates that mural will be complete by October 10th. Tune in tonight at 6 to hear more from the artist directly about what this project means to him. Keelan High School, Siouxland Christian School, and South Sioux City Middle School students broke from class today to hear from an Iraq War veteran, Melissa Stockwell. Stockwell was a second lieutenant in the U.S. Army when she became the first female American soldier in history to lose a limb in active combat. She tells the students she wouldn't let losing her leg stop her from doing the things she wanted to do, including becoming the first Iraq War veteran to qualify for the Paralympic Games in 2008.
It kind of normalizes the things that come into our life that we don't expect. And hopefully when that does happen, they can be like, oh, well, I heard Melissa's story and she was able to overcome, the loss of a leg and do these things. So maybe they think about that and it helps them kind of get through whatever it is that comes their way.
Stockwell adds that she will continue to travel and speak to schools and students and also work with her nonprofit, all while she figures out what her next steps are in her athletic career. And students at Galen Catholic School have now raised more than $40,000 for their school over the last several weeks. Today officially concluded their fundraiser with a J-Walkathon along with donations. Students also collected prayer intentions from the community. As they walked around the track today, they prayed for those causes. Painted rocks were also displayed along the track for the walkers to read throughout the day and also commemorate bringing their community together. American drug maker Merck says that the new pill cuts COVID-19 hospitalizations and deaths in half. The company briefed the White House COVID-19 response team on its latest findings. That was late Thursday, showing that patients who take the antiviral pill within 5 days of having COVID-19 symptoms have about half the rate of hospitalization and death than patients who receive the placebo pill.
In the placebo group, there were 8 deaths, and in the treatment group, there were no deaths. That's also very important and very good news.
The company, Merck, is seeing emergency use authorization from the FDA, and if they are approved, the company says it is prepared to produce about 10 million doses by the end of this year. Progress by researchers discovering ways to treat the virus, too. They've now uncovered what is believed to be a, quote, ultra-potent monoclonal antibody. Treatments like this have successfully kept patients out of the hospital, but Vanderbilt researchers say that some FDA-approved treatments have become less effective against new virus variants. They do believe this antibody might be strong enough to fight all variants, including those that could even develop in the future.
It's quite possible that in the near future, we will have other variants of the virus that show resistance to neutralization by some of the other antibodies that are still out there. So it's very important to keep developing new antibody therapeutic candidates.
If this particular antibody passes in clinical trials, it could soon be available to treat patients as early as next year. Senators tonight are criticizing Facebook executives on Instagram's policies for our youth. The latest out of Washington coming up in about 10 minutes.
And a few more showers are expected to drift through tonight and lasting into Saturday. The sunshine, though, does make a return pretty soon, and we'll have some seasonal warmth next week. Your 9 on 9 forecast coming up next.
You're watching KCAU 9 News with Sophie Erber and Chief Meteorologist Scott Larson. This is KCAU 9 News at 5.
Thanks for sticking with us. A lot of people heading out to football games tonight. We are already knee-deep in the high school football season. And if you have plans for things like Riversons and stuff this weekend, we might not be so happy about the rain in this forecast, Scott.
Yeah, it looks like the weather for the most part will cooperate, but probably a good idea to take some of those umbrellas and ponchos with you if you're planning to have some fun down at Riverside Park tomorrow, as we will still have a continuation of a small chance of some showers in our vicinity. Checking out things on the Ho-Chunk Center camera now in downtown Sioux City, you can see that we have a mostly cloudy sky, just a couple of breaks in those clouds occurring, and we've been tracking some rain showers as well through the afternoon here. Looking at temperatures as they currently stand, they're in the 60s and 70s throughout the area. It is 69 degrees in Yankton, 73 for Wayne. It is 72 outdoors in Sioux City, 70 degrees in Sheldon, and the temperature is now at 75 in Denison. So it has cooled off some, but it remains fairly humid under that thick deck of cloud cover. The wind is blown through from the southwest. We have it sustained between 5 and 15 miles per hour. Right now from the west southwest at 10 on Wednesday, expecting to see our temperatures slide downward as we approach next weekend with some more humidity and a few clouds, maybe a sprinkle here and there, but not a very active forecast, as it looks like we'll have some slightly cooler conditions down the road. Continue to send in those pictures to weather at kcautv.com. That email address, we'll send you a form, send it back, and we'll feature your pictures right here on KCAU 9 News.
Yes, looking forward to seeing those from this weekend. Thanks a lot, Scott. Well, facing a shortage of servers, one restaurant is turning to technology. How a robotic server is trying to get the job done while attracting new customers, coming up in about 8 minutes. But first, Facebook is accused of hiding some important data about the harms of social media on children and teens. What you need to know from a Senate hearing coming up next. Now to Facebook, under fire for the effect it's having on teens' mental health. During a hearing on Capitol Hill Thursday, one senator revealed his staff posed as a 13-year-old girl using a fake account, and what followed was disturbing. ABC's Andrea Fuji has more.
This morning, Congress calling out Facebook for hiding research about the negative effects social media, including its Instagram app, can have on young people.
While Facebook publicly denies that Instagram is deeply harmful for teens, privately, Facebook researchers and experts have been ringing the alarm for years.
An investigation by the Wall Street Journal revealed Facebook's own research found 32% of teen girls said when they feel bad about their bodies, Instagram made them feel worse. And teens blame Instagram for increases in the rate of anxiety and depression. During a Senate hearing Thursday, lawmakers compared the company to Big Tobacco.
In truth, Facebook has taken Big Tobacco's playbook. It has hidden its own research on addiction and the toxic effects of its products.
To study its effects, Blumenthal says his office posed as a 13-year-old girl on a fake Instagram account and followed accounts on extreme dieting and eating disorders.
Within a day, its recommendations were exclusively filled with accounts that promote self-injury and eating disorders.
Facebook argues teens connecting with other teens has an overall positive impact on their mental health.
We work constantly to improve safety and privacy protections for young people.
Then came the issue of policing so-called Finstas, or fake Instagram accounts often used by teens to remain anonymous.
Finstas often are intended to avoid parents' oversight.
Finstas are not something that we built. They built. So that's actually where Finstas come from, teens, not us.
A waiter job once open to people, humans, being filled now with a robot, and the response is largely positive. What makes Didi so popular with both management and customers? Coming up next. Welcome back. A Thai restaurant in Minnesota is testing out robots to serve customers. This, of course, after it got much harder to hire the real thing. Joe Mazan reports the new staff member is a customer magnet.
At Sawadi Thai restaurant in Minneapolis, sitting high in the wall, you'll find a painting of Buddha. These days, many here are also looking up to a robot named Dee Dee.
She's the celebrity. Like, everybody wants to see her, so.
Since adding Dee Dee to her staff last week.
We could put menus on there and then send it to a table.
Owner Cindy Harrison tells us the robot.
Well, she always comes to work.
is helping roll in the customers.
I said, let's go see the robot.
Well, they'll come in and they'll say, hey, we heard about the robot. We want her to serve us.
It was very nice, very fun.
I have a pork.
Because of a staffing shortage.
It's just been really tough to hire.
Cindy added a robot to their Minneapolis and Maple Grove locations.
She basically is just a food runner.
Dee Dee doesn't replace a server. She actually helps one.
Someone in the kitchen will take the food and put the food on her tray. And then she'll go out to a table and she'll kind of either announce that she's there or she'll meet the server there and the server will distribute the food.
Dee Dee will be here for the next 3 years, so there's plenty of time to meet the celebrity and get her autograph. Well, maybe not her autograph.
Enjoy.
Dee means good in Thai, so it works for us.
If Dee Dee is good, it will also work for Buddha.
We take a live look outside right now at Wayne America. Scott returns with one more check on your forecast just after this break. Stay with us. Before we wrap up here at 5, let's check in first with Tim for what's coming up at 6. Hi, Tim.
Hey, good afternoon. A football Friday here, that is for sure, Sophie. Coming up tonight at 6, Iowa's longest continuously running short subject film festival continues through tomorrow night at Sioux City's Promenade Theater. Close to 100 independent films in 5 categories: documentary, drama, comedy, horror and thriller, or sci-fi and fantasy are being shown over the course of 3 days. We'll hear from organizers coming up at 6. Meanwhile, a former general store dating back to the early 1900s is known today as a Christmas attraction in southeast South Dakota. After World News Tonight, Kelly Volk shows us how the community is working together to keep the unique operation going, even after all of these years. I gotta say, it seems a little weird to be talking about Christmas just yet, Sophie.
I'm not ready even for Halloween yet, so I'm with Tim there. Let's keep it in fall, right? And we do have some perfect fall time temperatures in the forecast.
We do, yeah. It's going to be quite a bit cooler here as we go through the next 9 on 9 forecast, as it looks like highs will stick in the 70s. A small chance of showers continuing tomorrow, but otherwise it looks like we'll stay dry for quite a long time.
Perfect. Thanks, Scott. Thank you for joining us. We'll all see you back here tonight at 6. And until then, have a great night.